So I thought I'd approach this from a somewhat different way. Several people have come up to me and said, I have no clue what you people are talking about. And having grown up on a farm on the, I used to say the middle of nowhere, but now I've changed it to the outer edge of nowhere. And having been a construction worker for a while before I managed to go to medical school, I thought I'd simplify it a bit. So what is an autoimmune disorder, I'd start to say. And there are these things called antibodies. And basically what they do is they're sort of these large plasma protein things. And they bind to certain receptors in places. So they bind to antigens. And antigens is any sort of target that they bind to. And they're built like this. And basically what happens if you have bad guys like bacteria or viruses that come into the system, they find it, they bind to it. They don't actually do much to it. They're sort of signal for other cells called killer cells to come in and then destroy it. One of my friends who fought in the Iraq war said, you know, he would, one of his jobs was to train a laser onto a target, and then a missile would then find the target and destroy it based on his laser focusing on the thing. So the laser itself did nothing except tell the missile where to go. So the antibodies really tell the killer cells what to kill. There are two kinds, B cells, which are derived from the bone marrow, and T cells, which are derived from the thymus. So that's the normal model. But the problem is, sometimes the antibodies can start binding to your cells, or to places they shouldn't bind to. And then your own immune system will then find those and start attacking whatever it's bound to. Why does it do that? Well, a lot of times there's a concept called molecular mimicry. So for example, and there seems to be a genetic component as well that you're susceptible to this. So for example, we know a lot about type 1 diabetes because we've spent a lot of money researching type 1 diabetes. And there are certain viruses that get into the system that they can get in there because they're disguised like part of you. If a virus came in not looking like part of you, it would be eaten immediately. So over evolutionary time, viruses have learned to look like parts of us. And so they sneak into you looking like, say, the islet cells of your pancreas. And when I say looking like, there's a certain, like a barcode that's on the top that's a protein sequence. And that protein sequence says, I am you, and I am your pancreas, and I am an islet cell. So it's just like a barcode or recognition code. And so it can get into the body, but hopefully your body soon will say, well, it's not a perfect code, and I don't think this thing belongs here, so I'm going to kill it. The problem, and then it should make a very, very specific antibody to bind to any sort of abnormality in that sequence that distinguishes it from a real islet cell. The problem is sometimes your immune system is a tad bit sloppy and will make an antibody that binds to anything that even resembles that. So in the midst of binding to the virus, it starts binding to whatever it was snuck in disguised as, like the islet cells of your pancreas. And then your killer cells come in and kill not only the virus, but your own islet cells of your pancreas. And then suddenly you're not making any more insulin and you have type 1 diabetes. So that concept called molecular mimicry seems to be the process that's going on in most things. My current wife was perfectly healthy, got a bad viral infection, and within a very short period of time developed full-blown rheumatoid arthritis. That's the usual story you hear. And if you think about many people's stories who develop POTS, it's very, very similar. Now, they're all kind of immunoglobulins. There's five major groups. I won't go into them here, but they do different things. And why did we even start to look at this? Well, because oftentimes they gave us histories that sounded like some kind of autoimmune thing. There are other markers of autoimmune or inflammation that can be elevated. Look, there's a thing called erythrocyte sedimentation rate and things that seem to indicate some kind of inflammatory process was going on. And again, you know this data about blood pooling, which I'm not going to go over, and these sort of symptoms that seem to come on quickly. One of my patients gave me a new book by Levison on Leonardo da Vinci, and it's really well worth reading. It's fascinating. But I got this quote from the book, learn how to see, realize that everything connects to everything else. And there's one of the problems in modern medicine is we have our feet firmly planted in the 19th century. In that every science begins with a concept called reductionism. Break things down to their minor components and see how they work. But the problem is that only takes you so far. So Newtonian physics, which is an example of reductionism, works perfectly as long as you're not doing anything complicated. If you're not trying to look at the behavior of the universe or molecular or atomic activity, falls apart. So they had to start looking at interrelationships between the components that they reduced. And from that, the idea of quantum mechanics and relativity was born. So ecology looks at the interrelationship between things. You can know the mechanism of photosynthesis, but that won't tell you how a forest works. And so the idea is we're starting to look more at these, what is called systems theory. So the first studies actually to do this historically were done at the Mayo Clinic, where they identified acetylcholine receptors, antibodies. We thought this was kind of a form of myasthenia, and there were some very good data. It turns out it's not a, it's a very small subgroup of people that have this, but it was the first time we had proven that this could occur. Dr. Raj has already shown you this data. This was a landmark paper that came out of the University of Oklahoma, which identified a series of different type of autoantibodies to various receptors, including ones that we said the alpha 1. And there's been, there's a whole bunch of receptors, and these receptors do different things, with the idea being if you mess with them, they can't do that thing. There have been a group of studies, and many of the people involved in those studies are presently here. We were meeting together upstairs, and we're actually all going to the NIH tomorrow to talk to the people there. And mainly from the University of Oklahoma, Dr. Fedorowski is here from Sweden, where he and his colleagues, both in Lund and also in the Karolinska Institute. If you don't know, the Karolinska Institute is where the Nobel Prize comes from. So they've been doing some extremely excellent work, and there's a number of papers. What I'm going to show you is our data. We used the Elisa study. We obtained these reagents from Germany. We chose to do this because it seemed to be a little more practical. And most testing, when you're testing for people for rheumatoid arthritis, when you're testing for Sjogren's, when you're testing for any of the rheumatologic disorders, the assays that are done are ELISA tests. That's what's the most commercially done thing. So we looked at a total of 55 patients, and what we found is just shy of 90% had very high elevated levels of autoantibodies to alpha-1 receptors. Interestingly, there are a second group of receptors that we looked at called muscarinic receptors, and these govern a variety of things. And for example, M3 muscarinic receptor autoantibodies are associated with Sjogren's. So we found that a large number, 50% of the patients who had elevations in alpha-1 receptor levels also had elevations in M4 receptor, autoantibody receptor levels. Now, only the people with elevated alpha-1 receptor autoantibodies had these. What do they do? We don't know what they do in people, but we know that in dogs and cats and rats and things like that, they help govern bowel motility. So again, that may be a clue to why some people, but not all people, can develop severe bowel motility disorders. We had a group of patients, about seven patients, that had elevated everything. And these people were really sick. These people were very, very sick, and usually were in wheelchairs and had a number of issues. So in summary, 89% of the patients we tested had these. And then another group of people. Now, by the way, there were some people that didn't have anything. There were five patients who didn't have anything elevated. And one of the questions that we have among ourselves, by the way, this is the one on the muscarinic ones. The problem is we don't know if there's cause and effect. These may be elevated as the result of some other process. So they may be a marker, but not actually the pathophysiology. And indeed, there's going to have to be a number of studies. So what's tantalizing is that we are all getting the same sort of results, irrespective of the methodology employed. You know, we can argue among ourselves over which methodology may be better or worse, but we're getting the same numbers, which means we're hopefully on the same pathway. I had lunch in London with a gentleman named Rodney Graham, who is the father of rheumatology. And he's 91 and still goes to work every day. And he watched rheumatology develop from a very primitive science to what it is today. And you know, and he said, when I listen to you talk, you are where we were 35 to 40 years ago. You know, when he started out, there were no antibody tests, there was none of that stuff. They assumed most things like rheumatoid arthritis were autoimmune, but nobody had proven it. And little by little, one by one, they found autoantibodies, they found different things, they began to experiment with immunosuppressive therapies. And so he said, you're redoing what we've already done. We'll probably do it faster because we have better tools and better equipment and we have their example to follow, but don't expect this to be an overnight thing. And while it's tantalizing to treat people with immunosuppressive therapy, I can tell you from personal experience now, over a year with my wife, it can be a nightmare. You basically create an AIDS patient who gets, I mean, she's had five major infections in the last year. I mean, you having grown up in part of the South, there was an expression which was never get something for nothing. When you start doing this stuff, you're taking on a level of risk from a therapy that we've never entertained before. All the therapies that we've used up to this point have been fairly safe. I have a background in cardiac transplantation. I was trained in cardiac transplantation when I was at Penn State. And people don't realize nobody dies of rejection anymore. Almost doesn't happen. What kills you are the drugs that we give you to prevent rejection. Again, these are sort of constructions that we're making. To give you a quick example, there was a woman that was transferred to us from the Cleveland Clinic. She had been in the hospital there for over a month. She could not get out. When she went to get out of bed, her heart rate would go to 180 and she would pass out. Failed every medicine. I'm sorry that gets cut off. I don't know how that happened. Everything was normal that we could test, and they had tested already at Cleveland Clinic. So they were transferred. They were actually going to put her in a nursing home and just leave her there. So the family had her transferred to us. We tried her on a number of other medicines. Nothing really worked. We started her on IVIG. She got a really wicked aseptic meningitis, so we switched her to the subcutaneous form. She was so deconditioned, we had to transfer her. We had to send her to our rehab hospital where we had to build her back up. But the last time I saw her, she walked into clinic and is back to leading a pretty normal life. Now, that's a one patient success story, and it's tantalizing, but it's not proof. So what I've shown you is the beginnings of a whole new phase in this, you know, that who knows where it will take us or where it will lead us, and I really can't tell you. And we may be being overly simplistic, but as Einstein said, make everything as simple as possible, but not simpler. Thank you.